unhappy with. They have the same man looking into a mirror, and he is a portly man, right, with the beer gut and everything, but his mirror image projection is that of a handsome man. Men don't do this to themselves. Women do. We are so body conscious, and we judge all the women around us. We'll say she's got some work done, yeah. or, you know, mm-hmm. we don't like her hair, or she should wear it this way. I think it's ingrained, and I don't know if it starts at childhood, if it's social, or if it's just genetic. I haven't been able to answer that question.
But don't you think it goes even further past looks? I mean, there are more women in this country are more highly educated than men. We are hard on ourselves because we want to be better. We want to be stronger. We want to be smarter. And I think that that goes into everything that women do. They want to be better at everything.
But I also think we're our own worst enemies.
Totally.
We're absolutely our own worst enemies because women will turn on each other quicker than a man will turn on a woman. And we've got beauty pageants, and you know I've participated
there
in
man
one.
Beauty pageants.
That was going to be my next
but they're
point.
Just not that big.
That was going to be my next point. The media hones in on the Miss America pageant and the Miss Universe pageant, and they're you know broadcast live across the universe, you know, and everything. Any sort of man pageant, I don't even know what they're called. You know, that's not given the same media attention as the ones for the women are.
We have a governor in California who was in a man pageant.
He was Mr. Universe.
He was Mr. Universe.
So,
I mean, that's pretty big.
He was in a pageant. How many people watched the pageant?
Well, that's true.
You know, I mean, they exist, but it's not watched. And you know, we're looking at these things.
They've
the
been replaced
media is
by people's
us,
sexiest man alive covers.
There
right?
you go.
That's what ends up happening. Is,
there you go.
Is that's where you end up really getting to know these handsome men is through Hollywood, or through these magazines,
where
or
the guy on the
events.
Cover gets to wear a T-shirt and jeans. Well, I think this whole plastic surgery trend is a sign of different and more bigger things. What do you think?
You could say that again. How's this for a cover? Time magazine just put on their cover, "Who Needs Marriage?" And there have been a lot of articles and news lately about marriage and the fact that it seems to be a dying phenomena. But let me read you this quote from this article. "Getting married is a way to show family and friends that you have a successful personal life. It is like the ultimate merit badge. But the reality is, our institution of marriage seems to be fading. If you look at just what the patterns were 30 years ago, people were getting married younger. They were getting married in droves. And that was the logical next step people did after finishing high school, which was the point. Now what has happened is a lot more women are going to college. A lot more women are entering the workforce. And consequently, they're delaying marriage. Or rather, marriage in general is just getting delayed, period, to after the point that we are all pretty much successful in our careers. And at that point, a lot of people just wonder what the practicality of marriage is anymore. The usual reasons to enter it, which was for stability, to raise kids, to have a dual income take us forward, those reasons just aren't there anymore. Mm-hmm. I read this article and I felt both encouraged and saddened at the same time.
Well, I think it varies a lot geographically too, because I have European friends who are like, yeah, marriage is so yesterday. I mean, they really, yeah. People don't get married as often. It's not just about delaying marriage to a later time. It's just choosing not to get married at all. Maybe even living in partnership with someone, having children with someone, and not being married. So the question is, if you don't need that marriage certificate to have all these things, to have a companion, to raise a family, then is it as valuable anymore?
And I think that when maybe I'm being too judgmental here, but when I was younger and all my friends were graduating from college, it wasn't so much about being married as being the merit badge. It was having the wedding was the merit badge.
Yeah.
Like, I'm planning the wedding. Mm-hmm. And then at a certain point as you get older and maybe you're single and, you know, it's not so important anymore. And, you know, to be honest, by the time I got to the point of being married, my friends were on their second marriages. And it was a different reason that people were getting married. You know, it was a different reason to come together. So who knows what the impetus of, is it the wedding, is it the marriage?
I don't think there's any broad brush stroke. I really don't.
True.
One of my colleagues at work had a boyfriend, lived with him 23 years. They just got married in October. After 23 years of living together and pretty much being married, you know, going on trips together, living together, owning homes together, they decided after 23 years, let's make it legal. Now, perhaps the fact of the matter that both of them are lawyers had something to do with it. But, you know, they came to a conclusion, you know, nearly a quarter century into their relationship that they wanted it.
Well, here are some interesting statistics just to fuel this discussion some more. In 1977, 43% of people said that an ideal marriage was one where the husband provides for the family. In 2010, that figure dropped from 43% to 30%. Here's something else. 19% of women were asked, should a husband provide for them? And only 19% said that was a requirement for them to find a husband. They did the same survey with men. 41% of men felt that they should be the provider in the marriage. Mm. There's a huge disparity there between our perceptions of what is needed from women's perspective. What the husband used to bring to the table is not so much of a need anymore, whereas the men still feel like if they're in a marriage, they need to be able to provide for the women. That gap, that gender gap that's emerging, mm-hmm. is one of the reasons why they're saying that we have more than just a marriage problem. We have a socioeconomic problem that's growing side by side along with this marriage problem.
Well, I think part of it has to do with the economy, too. I mean, we've all seen the figures for the past couple of years how a lot of men are losing their jobs and women are returning to the workforce mm-hmm. who previously were homemakers. And there is a tipping of the scales now where there are more women out there that are gainfully employed than there are men. And so that changes your perception of what you went into the marriage with.
And what you're willing to put up with.
Exactly.
Let's just face it. I think women feel that it's far easier now for them to exit a scenario because they don't feel quite as tied to it, or mm-hmm. rather they're not desperate enough to stay in it.
Right.
And a lot of them are now able to also say, well, I won't even enter into this situation because what are the perks? I'm bringing all the perks to myself, basically. Why enter into this and add complication into my world? That's you know, one of the reasons cited.
When did they say provide for you? Did they say financially?
Financially, specifically.
Well, you know, just a few minutes ago, ladies, we were talking about how hard we are on ourselves. But I think this data is showing us that men are very hard on themselves, too.
Because
here they
struggling.
Are, right? Even when women are not necessarily expecting them to be the sole provider in a marriage relationship, they have that expectation of mm-hmm. themselves. And that's a lot of pressure, particularly in these economic times. So we need to be mindful of that. We don't know what that internalized feeling is of not feeling worthy because you're not providing for your
family.
That's
a very good point, Shilpa. I'll just take your point there a little further. When I was in college, I took a wonderful class. It was called Images of Masculinity. Mm-hmm. And what that class was trying to show was that the image of masculinity has changed over the last several decades. It used to be we had very strong characters, whether they were on TV, embodying the husband, the provider, that very sort of stable image that we're used to. We had strong men on television followed by women. That has changed now. If you look at reality TV, you look at what's in the news, what's sensational today, it's all about marriages that don't work, people that are living single, that have these very different scenarios that they're living in, and it's acceptable. Socially, it's acceptable. So the image of masculinity has also changed. We don't have those strong figures anymore. Consequently, to your point, I think men are struggling to figure out where and how to fit and where and how to be that image, that what is that new image? They don't exactly have something to follow.